So, hello, welcome back for the second video today about the Peak Design Travel tripod, where I will first tell you what I like and what I dislike about this tripod so far. I only got it today, so this is definitely a first feeling and some tips. If you have seen the first video, which I talked about the L brackets, which was important for me. So now I want to show you basically why I got it and if it basically fulfills that first function. So we can argue that once I'm starting using it, will it stay in what part, will it break, will it behave that as I expected. I'm not sure if I can answer all these questions today, but I can answer a few questions for some tricks that I already found out. So the one that we already know is that the L bracket is working. I can already see that I'm using one trick that I figured, well, maybe even with more expensive or longer lenses, you can see that I can actually, when I put the tripod on, quite easily put also my Peak Design cuff over this. So if for some reason the camera would still drop out, it will be extra protected like this. So figured that was an easy trick that you can probably do if you want to. Again, I still have it on the lower bars, simply to get it in on the table and into the picture. So that's why it is like that. On the third part of this video, you can see all the parts in the background. I got all the different parts, so the special legs, but also the separate normal head plate. I got the spikes so that we can show all of them. But let's get going about some of the reasons why I got the Peak Design in the first place, or when I decided to pre-order it. So again, please subscribe to this YouTube channel if you want to, and if you are into the full frame cameras from Sony, please subscribe to our Facebook channel. We now are getting close to 15,000 people, and where we help each other and we kind of let's say frown upon posting pictures, posting unboxings, and being rude to each other. We kind of stop that in the butt, so that people don't feel threatened if they get to ask a question which might have already been asked before. So let's get going. So why the travel tripod? For me, it's quite simple. I know it's not the cheapest one. I paid with for all the parts about 500 euros. My old tripod was about 300 something. I will show the one later on without the head, so I came to about 400 something. It didn't have the extra parts, so it was more expensive, but not silly more expensive. But for me, size is everything, because I want everything to have in my bag. And if it would fulfill two features, A, would it be actually smaller and in a way more important, or at least as important, no weird parts sticking out. That was the point that they kind of sold me on. I also kind of like the head. I understand that there's no panoramic possibilities, but I like the fact that when I'm very early in the morning, or when I'm it's dark, I normally with a head sometimes confuse which knob I need to unscrew, and that can be quite dangerous if it's the one that's holding up the tripod plate itself. So I think the whole idea about that you only have one screw and you can sort of move it about and then lock it in again, I actually kind of think that's a very, very nice design. So that was another reason why I figured this might be a good buy for me. So, but I got it on the Kickstarter price, so that keeps the price a little bit down. Still, it's not a cheap product, but at least you know my motivation. So, one thing I wanted to show you is basically, I can't show you the full comparison between the three ones without showing you some pictures I took, because otherwise it just takes too much time. So let me set it up so that we can show you some pictures I took this afternoon about the differences in cameras. So here we go. So First, let's talk a little bit about weight. This is kind of random, but it will give you a good idea why I think some of this makes sense. This one is actually the first three or four pictures are all about the peak design, but in different configurations. So what you're seeing now, where it's 700 grams, is actually the one that is now on the table. It has the small sort of feet at the end. So what they call, I forgot what the name was, but it's like the light kit or something. It was $25 in the Kickstarter, and it allows you to take all of the legs off and basically create almost like a table sort of, or big table sort of tripod. And I also took the center bar out, which we had to do because otherwise it would not fit on the table like this. So this is almost like its minimum weight, and you can see that it's 700 grams. So next picture, it becomes a little bit more heavy because I left in the center bar. So it's still a table, big table tripod, but it would probably go up to about, I would guess about a meter would be my, if you also put the head up. So yeah, well, that's what it is. So the next one, I took these pictures because I was taking them apart. Let me first go to the Peak Design one, because I think that's kind of more interesting. You can see this is the full tripod in with the legs connected again, and all the parts that you basically need. And you can see that it's 1.26, 1.28 kilograms, which is fine. Or it is what it is. It's a 1.2 kilogram tripod. That does mean that it will not be stable for everybody. This is not the perfect tripod. This is the tripod that you take or with you when you're traveling. So it's a compromise. There's no doubt about it. But how much of a compromise we can argue about. So what I did, I am using on this camera. This camera, I'm using a Sirio bigger, semi-big tripod, and also we have a really small one, the smallest one that they ever sort of sold, which is too small for this camera, to be fair. So but I wanted to make that comparison. So what you see here is, let me first show you the small one. Of course we go in the wrong direction. So which is this one? It's a complete tripod. It was the first one that I still sometimes use it with an A6000 or something, but even then it does not, it's not the best solution. It works, but it's not perfect. But you can see it's 900 grams, so, or 850 grams with its head sort of included, in this case with a small lock. I'm showing you this because when we later look at the conference, so the diameter, you can see how close this actually is to the Peak Design one. So this was the bigger one. So you can see that this is 1.6 kilogram including the head. So you can see clearly that the smallest one is about 850. The biggest one is about two times the size, two times the weight, and you can see that the Peak Design is somewhere in the middle at 1.2 kilograms. Now, the next one, which is more important, is this is the big one at its fattest point. And you can clearly see that I can't even get my hand into the near the third leg of the tripod. It can't close up any further. I really tried. You have to be quite careful because you have to have the knob at the correct place. There's multiple knobs, so you have to make, when you are closing it up, you have to kind of fiddle to get it all the legs to hit the ball head. But there's no way to make it smaller, and you can clearly see that I can't really go around it completely. So this is the Peak Design one, and you can see again, this is the thickest part of the tripod, so I have quite big hands, and I think, I'm not sure, but I think I can almost totally reach around the whole thing in the middle where it's the thinnest. But I don't think that, I think there's a little bit of a weird comparison, so this is why, where I did it. But you can see the difference between, in my opinion, two comparable tripods in end result. As I tested so far, you can see the massive difference in size. So, and then compared to the small one, and it's kind of interesting, you can see, again, this is the one that I would not even use on a full frame camera, but you can see that this one also, my fingers are closer, but still not as close as I can do on the Peak Design one. So it's a big improvement, and both of these are also the flip around design. So you have to flip it around, and if you don't want the head up, you actually have to turn it back in. So it's not as easy as sort of the Peak Design, which just sort of goes out and you're done. So I think this was the reason for me to get it, because if I do that, and here you see them all three next to each other, and you can see what I mean. You can see that the length, the way that I took the picture, you can kind of see it, but you can see clearly that the length of the two bigger ones is about the same. I think they are actually the same, and the one next to it, of course, is smaller. But I only put it there to show you the diameter sort of as a comparison. But you can see sort of how they look next to each other. But you can also see how much less stuff is sticking out on the Peak Design one, which makes it much easier to store it. So I just took a picture them next to each other. Personally, I don't mind bending down a little bit if I are using the screen, depending on which camera you use. But if you're taking a landscape picture, I would probably use the Peak Design, which is the one on the right side. I would probably not even put it up, or only put it up a little bit, because it's then way more stable. And I don't need that height, but if need be, it can be done. Next to it, you see the Suryu, the bigger one, also five parts. One thing you do notice is that the lower leg of that one is quite a little bit thicker. Now, the weird thing is on the top, so if you test how stable they are, this is not a scientific test, but if I would compare them, I would argue that of the two bigger ones are about the same. You can also see that because you don't have to flip it around, that if you have the Peak Design one and you stick it out a little bit, just the base part, which we now have basically on the table, right? So the normal part without the lower part, I would argue that it's actually a tiny bit higher, as you can already see. Keep in mind that the Suryu ones are a little bit more to the camera, so it looks a little bit bigger, but they are exactly the same height in this configuration. Of course, you can already see that the small one, how small and unstable that is in a way. You should not use that for a somewhat more serious camera, even for a travel camera, which are not the most stable solutions to begin with, or at least, let me say it more carefully, you have to understand that this is a tripod for travel. You have to be more careful. You might have to weigh it down. You have to use it within its limitations. But that's basically the three tripods and next to each other. So for me, at least on Kickstarter price, with all its part, probably €510 I paid, if I did a translation, the Suryu one would be 400 and something when I got it. So gives you a little bit of an idea. Maybe this is a little bit tricky, but one of the reasons I wanted it to be able to take it with me more, right? And this picture makes less sense. Let me first show you this picture. I live in the Netherlands, and it can rain. So this is my normal bag, which holds all my camera stuff. It's quite a small bag. It's at least for somebody my size. It's a LowPro 350AW. And you can see that on the back of it, I always have this sort of wire, what you call it, used for your bike. And it's always been on there, and I stick normally my tripod can be in there, or a bottle of water or whatever, and 9 out of 10 times you will also find an umbrella there, because it's the Netherlands and it rains, so that's why I keep my umbrella. And most of the time if I'm out, I also put the cover on. So it looks like it really doesn't look like a camera bag, and people just think that you have a normal rucksack with you, you know, backpack with you. So, and you can see that once you put this one in there, which is quite easy to slide in because it doesn't have any parts sticking out, so it's quite easy to sort of slide it into the mechanism. Takes a second, it doesn't get stuck anywhere, and then I put the cover on and put it on my back. I don't plan to use the nice bag that comes with it. I use my stuff. I don't think it makes sense. I also remove most of the tools which are hidden on the leg, because I always have Allen wrenches with me anyway. I even mostly have one in my pocket. Let me see if that's true. Yep, got one in my pocket. So I can use that instead. I'm not sure. I think this was probably the last picture. Oh no. Got some more pictures. So this one I kind of is double up in a way, because you can see that this is the one which is my normal camera with the small rig 20-36. I wouldn't say prototype, but one that I changed a tiny bit myself. And it's actually this one we are looking at now, right? And you can see that it works. So I just took a picture to showcase that. That's probably it. Let me see if there's more pictures. Oh, there's more pictures. So somebody said, and I'm not saying that this is perfect. Would I use this if forced? Because I don't think it makes sense actually to put it all the way up. So, but just to show you that it is easily able to hold this. So this is A7R4 with a teleconverter and a 100 to 400 GM lens. And you can also see that I use this trap trick that I was already showing you here. And I did it over here too, because I figured in the future, if it falls, A, it does not bangle around in the wind, which is already good. But it also, if for some reason it would lock out, it might not drop all the way to the floor, but get stuck somewhere in between. Of course, I would probably use this if I'm shooting live. I would normally use a monopod, but I can imagine using this, but only as sort of an extra weight, if that makes sense, right? Like a monopod. In the other position, so in this position, I think it's quite usable. I can totally see this. Of course, if you take a long exposure, you will have to give it a few seconds to basically chill out. And I'm not sure how much wind it will take without starting to move. But I think this feels totally stable and comfortable for me. You have to make sure, of course, that it's smart to put the leg to the correct position in front of the lens. So I think this is probably all the pictures that I wanted to show you in this video. And again, for me, just to go back, let me find this picture. For me, the deciding factor was basically it's easier to take with me on my backpack. I know lots of people want to put it on the side, actually prefer it on the back, and you can see it's quite easy to do. The weight is also at 1.22 kilograms with the head, which is a small detail, but an important detail. That's actually quite nice, and you can see it hides quite easy. And you can also see that in the lower position, I would say always comfortable with, but in the semi-low position, it's kind of good enough for me for what it is, a travel camera, a travel tripod. You do see that the lower legs are a little bit more not as thick as the other one, but like I said, it feels that it bends a little bit more, because round, of course, is still a better shape than the triangle ones that they are using. But on the top part, I have to be fair to me, just by pushing them, they feel very close. So even in the totally extended position, which I personally would not use myself. On the lower position, so basically about this far out, that feels totally fine with me. And if you're doing landscape, then you can use the screen, or if you have to check, you can also bend down a bit and check. Not a big deal, works for me. So, and the other thing, and for me the most important thing, is basically this part of the story, right? So this was the old situation, which is what really quite difficult to sort of grasp around the whole tripod. And we're now moving to where this is the, basically the thickest part of the tripod. So, and I think for me that's a killer feature, and hopefully it will keep working and doesn't break down. They come with a life guarantee, so hopefully so far most of the Peak Design stuff have worked for me quite nicely. So in the next, I'm not sure if it's the next video, because I think I was also going to talk about likes and dislikes. So there's a few things, let me get back to them. So the likes I already kind of talked about, the weight and stuff like that. I also like this mechanism for moving it around. I know you can't do any panoramas, and at least not as easy, although you have a level or so. Not sure how much of a big deal that is, but I'm also thinking about, or even co-designing, a small plate that you can sort of put in between that would resolve this. So let's see what happens there. So what else don't I like? Simple and small things. So one thing I really don't like, so let me put this camera over here and go to the top view. On most of these pictures, this ball, this leveler is green. It is working, and I've looked at quite a few pictures. It looks like all the ones that they are shipping, they are actually not green, but they have some white fluid in there. I think it's quite difficult to see. Maybe it's a styling thing, but not a big fan. The second thing we already talked about, I would have preferred that they've put more holes in here, so that you had a little bit more options if you want to put a an L plate or a cage on there to make sure that you can still use the locking mechanism. And I also really don't like this screw, which is kind of sharp. Now I'm pretty sure this is a default sort of size, so I will find another one, or I will put some rubber around it so that it's not as sharp. I found the same thing, but then I need to get this part, which is now sort of lingering around, which is the arm part. I also found the same thing not sure what's the best way to show it, like this. This is the part that you can use to connect, to put your iPhone on top, and it works, but I do find that even these parts are quite sharp, and if you put your phone in there, it's also a little bit crooked, so it's not straight, it's sort of like this, you can see this part. Is that a big deal? No, because you can sort of flip it around, but I found it weird. But I also find that this is, it could have been less sharp. So depending on how, what kind of a rubber or housing your phone is in, or if you're using your phone without any protection, I can totally see that this might damage your phone because this is quite sharp. So I'm also not a big fan of that. For the rest, I think, already looking at some parts, I would not be surprised, not that I care too much to be fair, that it's quite easy to scuff it up, especially the aluminium part. You can already see by taking it in and out of the mechanism that there's a small sort of, you see it there, scuff already there. So, does that bother me? Not that much, but I do think you should keep in mind that this will be a product that will start looking used after a while. So that's kind of, I think, so far. Oh, yeah, the other thing which I understand but not a big fan of is that, and I can of course not really show you, but there's only one point where you can put it, right? So one position that you can put a leg in. So, and also, so if you bend it down, There's not like a second position. There's only this position, which is a normal position, but there's no in-between sort of position. I understand why they did it, because otherwise it would have put even more pressure, because it's now, of course, if it's like this, then the legs don't take as much side pressure. If you put it like this, it would bend even more. So I think that's... it would probably, even on the other tripod, not be smart to use that position. It does mean that if you have to place it against a rock or something else, the way you might want to use this sort of in-between position, that you can't use it anymore. So these are the three things I found so far that I actually don't really, am not a big fan of. There's quite a few things I am a fan of, which we will get back to when we are talking about the parts, which I've decided to make part number 3. So, yeah, see you in the next one, and bye-bye.